here with ex-world-class light-heavyweight and super middleweight, the inimitable Iceman John Scully. As you can see in the background, we've got the brand new rival boxing boots store, which I believe you think is the best boxing store in the world.
I still spar on the rival ground.
Yeah, and you still spar a lot of rounds.
I know that.
We put some of us ex-fighters to shame on. I don't do anything but move around with white collar fighters and try to come hit me with a half a cent, for the sake. But Ice, I mean, I know that you, I know about your pro career. I know a lot of those details. I don't know an awful lot about your amateur career. I do know you've got a fantastic knowledge of amateur boxing in that 70s, 80s and 90s period.
Well, that was my era. You know, I came up in the 1980s. I was actually with Roy and I sparred.
Yeah.
If you go to YouTube, you see us sparred. I was in Sugar Leonard's gym as amateur. I was in the amateur Olympic class with the little ball, Roy Jones, Martin Sharp Johnson.
Yeah,
that was
here tonight.
I invited Mark. You know, that's what I love about the boxing. Like Mark, I knew Mark was in town. I said, "Oh, I said, Mark, you gotta come over. We're all boys gonna be here." So that's what I love about the boxing is the camaraderie. You know, but that's when that's my era. Gerald McClellan, Rudy Clay, those type of guys.
What Olympic year were you targeting?
1988.
In 1988, which would have been Seoul, obviously, we know. It became notorious for having for featuring possibly the worst miscarriage of justice in an amateur boxing match in history.
Oh, I mean, there's never been a robbery that late. Not even pro. I mean,
maybe Benel was Jose Luis Ramirez.
I mean, that was never. I mean, there's nothing you could say. Nothing. There's zero you could say why Park Seung-hoon got that fight. Park Seung-hoon was a good fighter.
Yeah.
You don't know.
But he got
was a good fighter. Yeah, he got them. But Roy was brilliant.
Yeah. And many other fights too. So.
I remember leaving for the airport. I ran early in the morning, and I called my mother after I run from Florida. And I remember calling her, and the police answered the phone. And they said, "Listen, your mother had to go to the emergency room." I said, "Listen, I'm leaving for Germany in like 3 hours." And they said, "Well, I'm gonna tell you, like, she's in the emergency room." So I had to.
That's no kind of mental
preparation. I had to make up my mind what to do, and my father told me to go. He said, "You can always come back if something happens." So I went to Germany under those circumstances. Now, with that said, I'm not saying that's why I lost, because Henry Maskey was an extremely good fighter. He was difficult. His height was a big problem.
When you analyze the upper tier opponents you faced, which one would you regard as the best fight you fought? Would it be Michael Nunn, for instance?
I think Nunn was the best fight that I fought in terms of that level. I think the best in terms of most difficult for me was Maskey, because Nunn was willing to engage. Nunn was a boxer, but he'd fight. He'd dig in.
Yeah.
Maskey was such a professional boxer that he would not engage. And that was my only chance to win, really. And I tried, you know, I'm talking to him, and I stepped on his foot one time, and he wouldn't budge. He was very methodical. It was inspiring, to be honest with you. I was impressed with the way he was able to keep his momentum the way he wanted it.
Moving on to the reason why we're all going to be congregating in Las Vegas. So tomorrow night, rematch between Paul Cometh and Junior and Mike Medina. Briefly, do you see it different at all from the first fight?
I do. I think Mayweather is maybe, if not the smartest, the top two or three smartest fighters in the world. And I think he's going to adjust Right, and the other guy doesn't have the tools, I don't believe, to adjust himself the way Mayweather can do both. Mayweather knows he messed up, he fought the wrong fight, he allowed the wrong fight to be fought, and he's going to fix it. I have this room.
That's precisely what I mentioned to him as well. Right. In terms of the sense of historical posterity and the sense of perspective, I know you're quite an historian with an appreciation for the fighting of yesteryear as well.
Right.
When Mayweather has baseball caps branding himself as the best ever, how do you assess that claim and that branding in the context of guys like Ray Robinson and Charles?
He's trying to convince people that don't know better.
Yes.
You know, it's better to have 100 people that don't know better saying yeah than a couple guys who do and say no. You know what I mean? And, you know, you get people talking like, yeah, he's the best ever. And then you go, yeah, he is the best ever. And before you know it, everybody's saying it, even though they have no idea what they're saying.
Well, Joseph Goebbels once said, tell a lie often enough and it's believed. But and that's no disrespect to Floyd, incidentally.
No, Floyd's a great fighter, but Archie Moore and holy crap. I mean, it's almost insulting. Sugar and Leonard, I mean, Roberto at one time was like 79-1.
Yeah,
I mean,
like he was 72-1 when he was
72-1.
Going into the match.
I mean, 72-1. I mean, come on.
Closing question.
Yes.
Would you put Lil Floyd in the top 20 all the time, pound for pound on balance?
I can see that. I can see that. Yeah, I can definitely see that. Yeah, I you know, when people take it as an offense, if you say, oh, he's not the best ever, you go, oh, you don't think
that's
he's good.
Respect.
Oh, no, he's great, but the best ever is a huge saying. You know what I mean? That constitutes a lot.
Well, I'm very grateful for your time. I'm also very grateful for the opportunity to actually meet you in the flesh after a lot of felt kinship on social media.
Yeah, oh,
thank you very much.
I appreciate you, but thank you.
All right.